Today was a good day. Today was a good day.
Hello, Pacific Bitcoin. How's everybody doing? Excited? You pumped? We're here to talk about Lightning. Brace yourselves. So, we've got an incredible group up here, titans in the Lightning Network. But we are at a Bitcoin conference. So I'd like to start from the basics and really ask you guys, why Lightning? Why do we need Lightning, and what problems exist that you guys are aiming to solve?
Great question. And first of all, let me just say it's a pleasure to be here. It's a pleasure to be talking to all of you and bringing you guys that are mostly just Bitcoin on-chain guys a little bit of what we're building, right? And you know, to your question, why Lightning, why it's necessary, it's basically a scalability problem. At this point in time, I believe the max transactions that we can push through on the on-chain is something like 200 million per year. And what we're trying to do, and what I believe Bitcoin is hoping to do, is just to onboard the world into Bitcoin. That's 8 billion people. You can't route transactions for 8 billion people on 200 transactions per year. So we need a scaling solution. We need a better way to route payments, to route everyday commerce. And what we hope happens, I'm sure, is that not only are we running all of the transactions that are available today, but those that are going to be available in the future, because we're that much more efficient.
Got it.
So, of course, at LightSpark, we spend a lot of time thinking about scalability and really taking Lightning to the next level. But let me maybe zoom out a little bit, right? Why are we all here? We have this fantastic, always available, real world asset that millions of people have already embraced. And we also have a network. We have Rails that we can use not only to store value, but also to transact value. And for the success case to actually materialize, we need those rails to scale first to millions, then hundreds of millions, and then billions of users. And it's not just about technical scaling. We need to make those rails capital efficient. At the end, these rails will be competing with all the legacy systems, with other layer ones, with other scaling solutions. Now, you and I all know why Bitcoin is the right choice, right? It's the most decentralized network with the most global liquidity, the one that has this wonderful infrastructure all over the world that you can tap into. It's already there. It's the network with all the right network effects. So it's just ready to become not only a global settlement layer, but also the one that everybody uses in all sorts of experiences. And that's the second part. So beyond the technology, we also need to improve the UI UX. How will consumers actually experience this? How do we make it simple? How do we allow someone that doesn't understand Bitcoin yet, that doesn't need to know about crypto, to use this to actually get a job done? There's millions of people sending money, remittances, cross-border flows, payments on digital platforms. You have creators, right, trying to capture new revenue streams. There's all these use cases for which traditional payment rails are really not fit for the job. And we at LightSpark really believe that Lightning is the solution. Bitcoin is the right asset. Lightning is the way to scale it. And together, we can really take this to the next level so that, you know, 5-10 years from now, people won't even know that they're transacting on Lightning. Lightning will be everywhere. Bitcoin will be everywhere, and people will be just using this as this wonderful, not only store of value, but also medium of exchange.
Yeah, no, I think that's a great, I agree with both previous responses. I think the only thing that I'll add as well is there's all the technical reasons for, you know, needing a scaling layer, but it's also gives us the ability from a protocol level to experiment and do things without affecting, you know, the base layer. And so naturally, Bitcoin has been very slow to change, which is a very good thing. It gets criticized, but it's a very good thing in the long run. And well, Lightning allows us to build new experiences, experiment, do new things that maybe either don't make sense on chain or enable just a lot more new use use cases that you just outlined. And so I think that the ability to move faster from a protocol, from a community, from all of the things that people want to build is very, very important as we look at, you know, if we're very slow to change, we're probably going to get left behind. We aren't going to adapt fast enough. And so we need that fastness to be able to iterate, not only in the transactions themselves, but in the ability that we develop and we integrate and we do all these different things. So you think about machine-to-machine payments, more embedded internet experiences, which are only possible inside of Bitcoin and Lightning. And so I think that that's another important call out, is our ability to develop the protocol and the interactions, the way that people use Bitcoin, we can adapt that without having to touch the base layer, essentially.
I love it. I love it. Well said. So I guess we tend to say that Lightning and Bitcoin are inevitable, but there are a lot of challenges, especially with the Lightning Network, in terms of adoption and everything you just mentioned. What are some of those challenges? What do you guys, with each of your companies, you guys are aiming to solve specific problems that impede mass adoption. So I'd like to go through and have you guys explain what you think some of those are and how you are specifically trying to solve those issues with the projects that you guys are running.
Okay. So at IBEX, we have a very specific view of Lightning and the Lightning Network. So how we approach it and how we see it is as a hyper-efficient settlement network at its core, right? And probably gonna anger some people here, but we don't really care about the value that's getting transacted at the endpoints, because we can leverage Bitcoin as the most liquid asset out there, maybe beyond the dollar, to actually create these instant settlements as transaction flow happens at the endpoint. So you can go from dollars to pounds to quetzales to Mexican pesos to Argentinian pesos, all instantly, really instantly, and you're just clearing the transactions constantly, right? So that's the first step. And the reason why we can do this is that Bitcoin is really unique, and I'm talking here Bitcoin, not the unit of account. I'm talking Bitcoin, the protocol. Bitcoin is the first and only global database, financial global database that there exists. And it's non-trivial to replace it. So you can't come in and just, you know, plug in another blockchain. Doesn't work like that. You don't have the decentralization. You don't have the security. And at this point, you can't build it. You just can't. And so for us, leveraging this capability of working on one single source of truth to route and settle financial transactions globally is key.
And look, I hate to say this at a Bitcoin conference, but Bitcoin is not inevitable and Lightning is not inevitable, right? So I've been now in Bitcoin for over 10 years, and it is on to us to make the Lightning and Bitcoin experience the best one there is in the market. That starts by making it extremely easy for developers to build things on Lightning, rapid prototyping. How many lines of code should it take, right, to be able to move Bitcoin in real time across the globe? The minimum number. We really need to capture the developer mindshare. We need a Bitcoin renaissance. We need people to come onto Bitcoin, and I think it's happening, and start creating the new types of apps, the new type of, you know, financial interactions on Bitcoin. Now, Bitcoin can only support so much, and this is where Lightning can play a really important role. If we make the entry point to Lightning easy to use, enterprise grade, so that we also get some of the larger participants to join the ecosystem and start moving value over Lightning, how many years are we in and most exchanges are not on Lightning today? Right? It's kind of a no-brainer. If you're a market maker, if you have managing liquidity, why not do that on L2? You could do it high frequency. You can lower your cost of capital. These are all things that we can build together, but there's a gap. And so that gap is both technology, but it's also product. Again, the consumer at the end of the day will not embrace Lightning, like many of us have all done, by kind of learning about Bitcoin, learning about all the complexity, and kind of getting enamored with that brilliant and elegant solution. They will want to get a job done. So we need to get Lightning to the point where it can get somebody's job done, and it can do it really well. I think, you know, we'll get there, but let's not be complacent. I think it requires all the people in this room and outside of this room to make Lightning and Bitcoin the developer platform of choice, and one that every company on the planet will have to interface with because it is the global settlement asset.
Yeah, and I think additionally, I mean, there's when we think about how can we increase, you know, adoption and all these things. I think there's a ton that, you know, can be improved on the UX and all the things that I think are pretty fairly well known. But yeah, I agree with the developer ecosystem and being able to really push people to experiment and build things, and then being able to, you know, launch that into production or, you know, kill it and start over, and being able to really do that in a very, very quick iteration is very important as we look at bringing the protocol into, you know, more hands, more people, more use cases. So that's something, you know, we focus on enabling at Voltage, is really making it very easy. And I think that the thing that is, you know, the most important thing that we focus on is also doing this in a way that is true to the protocol. So if you're using some abstraction or like some version of someone else's Lightning, I think that it you lose out on a lot of the benefits of like true instant settlement and actually being able to do peer-to-peer transfers and all of the things. And so, you know, when we think about it, we really want to enable all of these experiences, solve all these problems, but do it in a way that doesn't compromise in the protocol itself, the benefits that you get of Lightning and Bitcoin. And I think that the only way is, you know, if you start really looking at, you know, doing things with someone else's services, then you really start to lose out on like that, the unconfiscatability, like the true instant settlement, all the benefits that come along with Lightning. So it's very important to solve all these problems and get it into the hands of more people, but we shouldn't be compromising on the ways that we do that and just settling for, well, this is hard, so let's go, you know, custodial, or this is hard, so let's do it in this way. I think that really challenging ourselves to do it in a way that preserves the protocol is very important.
Yeah, I could not agree more. Just to go into a little bit more specifics, you know, a bunch of us got together and created something called PlebNet, which you may have heard of, and we did that originally because it was incredibly difficult for us to figure out how to keep track of everything, how to effectively open and manage the channels. And I think one of the things that's so exciting is that each of you is building these tools that allow, as you said, businesses who are interested in having effective and very quick payments, doing remittances, to an individual who is just interested in prototyping something really rapidly. You can just go on your platforms and immediately just be like, deploy, and it will take care of the vast majority of complexity, which really is an impediment to the average person. You know, not many people are as dedicated and willing to kind of bash their head against the wall. And so I think that's so important, and I think it often goes unacknowledged.
Yeah, and look, there's important complexity, right? When it comes to keys and self-custody, those are really important principles, and people, you know, embracing crypto should understand those, because we've seen the consequences of when that's not taken into care. But there's also redundant complexity. So as much as we get enamored with the technical concepts, we need to be able to bridge the concepts that are important in Lightning to a much broader audience. If you start talking about nodes, channels, rebalancing, inbound and outbound liquidity, you realize really quickly that as you're bridging out of Bitcoin, you lose so many people. And so we need to do a much better job at exposing and educating on the important dimensions of complexity. Again, you know, we're building in a non-custodial way because we think it's a really important principle. And also, you're not going to get institutional adoption if you don't have a non-custodial solution. There's no way that a custodial model will scale once you have like neobanks and fintechs and all sort of very large scale wallets onto the network. But at the same time, I think there's almost this rite of initiation in Lightning where we started the journey the same way. We set up our nodes, we set up our channels, and quickly we realized that there were important dimensions of complexity and others that were just confusing and actually not really helpful.
Yeah, absolutely. Either of you have any other thoughts on that note?
No, I mean, I definitely agree with that. And I think that there's exposing, I think that, we've seen people start to solve these problems in really interesting ways, like Mutiny Wallet, for example, is the latest kind of like non-custodial Lightning wallet that they've built it in a really interesting way. And I think that ultimately that comes down to the technology and what we're service providers like us are able to build on top of that protocol. So, you know, I want to care about the channels and the nodes and everything so you don't have to. And I think really taking on that responsibility so we can, you know, keep the benefits of the protocol, like I just mentioned a minute ago, but also be able to not, you know, not expose all of it, you know, drink from a fire hose type onboarding, because that then, you know, limits our ability to actually scale. And so I think that, yeah, it's very important. And I think that there's just increasing amounts of like protocol level developments that make it so much easier for service providers like ourselves to actually be able to offer these types of solutions. And so I think that's very exciting where, you know, it's an exciting spot, I think, for myself to be able to operate, look at all of these protocol developments like splicing and all of these things and figure out how can we use this to better enhance the customer experience on top and like for the builders and all those people that want to interact. So I think there's a lot of opportunity in to come inside of the base layer or the protocol level changes in Lightning that will eventually bubble up into better user experiences that they don't know they're using splicing, but it gives them a better experience.
Got it. Good.
I have a question here for the panel actually, because something caught my ear when you were talking about it, and I would like to know how you guys define non-custodial.
I think, look, the definition is simple. You control the keys. We cannot interfere with operations around those keys, your money, your crypto. That's our definition.
Yeah, I mean, it's the same thing. I think that there's there's also like a big spectrum of like, okay, so custodial is probably black and white. Trust is like this really abstract thing of like, you know, even when you're creating like channels with other participants, there's like there's kind of trust baked into the whole system, and you can choose, it's a spectrum, and you can choose where you want to operate inside of that spectrum. So it's a very complex topic that has a lot of variables, a lot of opinions on it. But yeah, I think that everything that you just said is accurate. And I think that there's a spectrum that people can evaluate as they start going down the rabbit hole.
Okay, because I view it, if we take it to like, let's say the real world, right? To me, non-custodial would be, there's a warehouse, there's gold in there, only I have the key, non-custodial, right? But in Lightning, as far as I know and in our experience, the best we can get to is, let's say, a joint custody. And I'll explain why. Because the moment you start opening channels with counterparties, there's two keys there, right? There's my key, there's the other guy's key. If my database comes out of sync, right, with that, with the other guy's database, the funds are lost, right?
Well, so first of all, we did this in the backstage we agreed not to do, which is get too technical and bore you with a lot of the, you know, in the weeds Lightning details. But let me try to take this a different way. So at Lightspark, we have the luck of working with Taj, one of the co-authors and inventors of the Lightning protocol. And those are really important questions. And I think at the end of the day, what will really matter is that if you're signing an operation, that signature is coming from the customer, right? But I would like to kind of zoom out, because I think, look, custodial, non-custodial, there's going to be all sort of solutions on Lightning. I think some entities, like larger exchanges, will thrive in a custodial model, and that will have some benefits. In some other parts of the ecosystem, you'll need a non-custodial service, whether it's all the way down to a mobile phone or an institution, right? So if you want to onboard a large global custodian onto Lightning, today, those custodians, they're essentially non-custodial to their assets and customers in the traditional financial world. So they want to replicate that. So ironically, non-custodial works all the way to the small user on a mobile phone and for a very large, you know, custodial bank at scale. But look, if you zoom out, let's assume we can solve all the technical challenges of signatures and all of that, which you know, I'm fully confident that we'll land on a really good place. There's a bigger challenge that I don't think developers pay enough attention to, which is capital efficiency. If we cannot get Lightning to be capital efficient, if those Bitcoin on the Lightning network don't keep moving at very high velocity, Lightning is not going to be able to compete with, you know, RTGS systems, traditional payment rails, other L1s. And so I believe Bitcoin is the best technology, but again, it's not inevitable. And so if we want Bitcoin and Lightning to succeed, we also need to focus a lot on the unit economics. How do we make Lightning dirt cheap, highly available, easy for developers to build on, and really bring it head to head with every other possible alternative on the market?
Well, from my point of view or our point of view, it's already dirt cheap, so to speak, right? Because when you're routing transactions and you're collecting fees in the order of millisatoshis, which is fractions of a fraction of a cent, right? then it's you know, in that sense, it's really, let's say, inexpensive. To your point about capital allocation, capital management, right? We agree as well, because that's kind of how we're building, right? And the whole premise behind how we're built is that the more transactions you route, the more efficient you can be. You can send payments faster. Your channel optimization becomes better, as instead of being, you know, constantly segregating into multiple nodes and channels. So yeah, to your point. But again, it comes back to my question of custodial and non-custodial and the spectrum of solutions. I do think, and I'm pretty much alone, I think, here in thinking this, but gotta speak my mind, is that for most people, custodial makes the most sense.
I think we'll need both. Right? And again, non-custodial would matter for the very small participants and the very large ones, because they will want to be in control of their keys as a custodian for their customers. But, you know, to your point about fees, transactions on Lightning might be cheap, you know, the routing is low cost, but what about that precious Bitcoin that's been locked in channels? That's super expensive, right? So Bitcoin is one of the most valuable assets out there, and taking my Bitcoin and locking it into all these channels, I really need to put it to use. I often use this analogy of ride sharing, right? So when Uber or Lyft would launch in a new city, they would subsidize drivers to just sit there and wait. You would open your app and voila, the car would show up in 5 minutes. That was extremely expensive. It was not sustainable. And in fact, those companies went through a number of struggles as they scaled that model of locking liquidity, drivers, in place so that you could get a good experience trying to get a ride. As the system scales, we need to develop the technology, and that's why we've invested a lot in AI, to predict where liquidity is going to be needed, to move it in time in the right place, and just make Lightning really competitive. There are payment networks today that are dirt cheap. Pix in Brazil, UPI in India. These systems exist. I mean, the United States is behind, but they're really available 24/7 and cheap, and we want Bitcoin to compete with that, so we got to do a much better job.
So yeah, I want to jump in, and just because Graham has been patient, I want to hear what Graham has to say, and then I want to ask a slightly different question and take us in a...
I think answer that and build on it. So maybe, I don't know if this is your next question or not, so I'm going to steal your job, Pete. But I think that, like, to your point on, like, capital efficiency, things like that, I think that it goes back to how do we, like, measure success in the Lightning Network? And I think that the ways that people really think about that today is the channel count, channel capacity, node count, which are the public metrics of Lightning. Well, those are, like, really, really poor metrics to actually track a system on, like Lightning, that is pure to peer, because as we've seen, you know, there's been a large drop in capacity on the Lightning Network because of Flokes basically closing channels. That is idle capital that hasn't routed a payment, so it's basically, there's no reason for it to be in the network. And so those metrics are very, very bad at tracking the success or usage of Lightning, because people want to be capital efficient. The more that we can do in Lightning with the least amount of Bitcoin locked into it, the better. And I think that all the haters out there really kind of don't, it doesn't parse with, like, the Ethereum world, where, like, the more value locked, the more revenue, well, all of those things. So it's very different, and people have a really hard time thinking about that. And so how do we measure success in Lightning? The success really comes from the things of, like, number of transactions actually sent and received, how many people are using it, the volume of transactions over the network, which are all inherently private things. There is no global consensus that shows this is how many transactions are through the Lightning Network. It is all directly peer-to-peer with you and your counterparties. And so, you know, you can have maybe an estimate by routing payments, doing all these things, but, like, ultimately, it's completely impossible to know the true amount of transactions routed through Lightning, because, you know, we, like, provide an LSP service that opens up, you know, we have thousands of channels into mobile phones for that non-custodial use case that those don't show up in the public metrics. And so there's just ways like that that really, there's so much more going on behind the scenes, and that's it's important to draw the distinction of how is Lightning being used, and it's very hard to tell from those public metrics. So it's important to focus on, it makes people really frustrated, because they want to know how much usage is going over the Lightning, and there's no answer. There's no, like, direct 100% view on it like you can with, like, on-chain Bitcoin. And so as we look at success, I hope that capacity keeps decreasing, because we know, I mean, our customers are sending and receiving transactions just fine. They're increasing their volumes day over day, and we see that with a decreasing in capacity. And so I think that it's important to understand the difference in those metrics.
I agree. Any thoughts on that note?
Couldn't agree more. I mean, you probably just made really happy our head of data science, Josh, who spends a lot of time thinking about all of that. And look, we've built our own estimates of what the actual TPV is. What is the payment volume on Lightning? And it doesn't matter. You can change the assumptions. Is it 30 million TPV, 100 million TPV? You can get pretty reliable estimates. But the reality of it is we need to get it to the next level. We're nowhere near the payment system and the alternatives that we're trying to compete on. Again, Bitcoin and Lightning are not inevitable. We need to build better user experience, better developer experiences, better tools for enterprises really to start using this, custodial, non-custodial, all the different flavors so that, you know, Bitcoin and Lightning can really succeed.
You have that?
Yeah, no, it's interesting about the liquidity management because it's something we've looked at deeply as well.
Absolutely.
And where it gets really interesting, and I'm going to do a rough example here, is let's take a gas station. So imagine you could route gas station transactions through one specific node, one channel, right? This is just theoretical. Now, gas stations probably, you would say, average transaction $60, maybe max transaction $500. Let's triple that. Let's make it a node channel availability of $2,000, right?
Filling up a boat or something.
All gas stations, if you get quick enough with the implementations of, you know, AI tools to just rebalance your liquidity and you're just flipping it back and forth between incoming and outgoing, on $2,000, you could theoretically move all of the gas stations transactions in the world.
And maybe let me take another spin at this, which is, we talk about things like rebalancing channels, like paying and creating artificial transactions to get Lightning to work. But the reality of it is we need to get much, much better at smart routing in the first place. The network should not need rebalancing if we're designing the routing in the right way from the beginning. And so all of this is coming. So the short version is, I think Lightning will scale. Lightning will get hundreds of millions of users over the next few months, and then more and more and more. But then there's also challenges on layer one, right? So it goes back to what do we need to do on Bitcoin layer one to ensure that Lightning can also keep growing and we don't hit a wall and we're not victim of our own success.
Yeah, absolutely. And just for everyone in the audience, when we're talking about channel rebalancing, which is a huge, it takes a lot of time if you're not using some kind of automated system, as you're pushing, you know, sats through a channel, all the sats end up on one side. It's like beads on a string. And then you have to figure out a way through other channels to basically rebalance it so that you can accept or, you know, or send payments as needed. So it's a constant challenge. And if you're not using some kind of system, you have to go through like every single day and like, okay, where am I? How am I doing? And then you're playing this Tetris game and you're moving stuff around, you're optimizing.
I totally agree with you. And I think like in today's world, a lot of people that are doing that still are like the hobbyists that like they just lay low to know, you know, like know all those things. I think for anyone that's using it, real use cases in production, there's much less of that happening, which is a good thing. I think that as you look at the Lightning Network today, it's in a completely different network than it was last year. It's going to be a completely different network in next year compared to like, okay, maybe rebalancing isn't a thing anymore. We have all these better ways of doing things. So I think that but the back to the first comment that I said of the talk was around the ability to move fast and make changes. I think that we see that and we're going to continue to see that so we can really bring this protocol into, you know, millions of people, billions of people, and really onboard more and more folks. So just want to make the distinction on where we're at now, and we're going to continue to evolve.
Yeah, also to be clear, like I'm talking about like the full-blown or like very small hobbyist, right? I'm like, oh, I don't want to put more than, you know, 100,000 sats in a channel, right? If you're like a large company, you're having these, you know, channels that are like a quarter of a Bitcoin, a half a Bitcoin, a Bitcoin, and a lot of those problems get a lot simpler, you know? But so we've kind of talked about some of, well, I'll put it another way. How do we increase the robustness of the Lightning Network, right? If you have these very large nodes that are able to transact large payments and need less rebalancing, and then you also have hobbyists that are on the network, how do you effectively, you know, create a more robust Lightning Network overall?
Well, for us, it basically all comes down to DevOps. So you need to have really good DevOps team. A lot of this Lightning is just database management, as odd as it sounds. So because of the way we're set up and the services we provide with the instant fiat conversion and the stable accounts and a lot of other stuff, because we go beyond just like I said at the start, beyond just having to settle on Bitcoin and receiving Bitcoin at the end of the day, for us, it's that. It's really having the best database infrastructure we can.
Got it. To you, and then quickly to Graham.
I mean, in the early days of the internet, right, everybody was running their mail server. Nobody does that pretty much anymore today. So we need to get there, right? We need to get to a point where, while retaining the resiliency, the security, the decentralization of the network, we make it extremely easy for everyone to connect to the network, to be highly available, to be able to send and receive payments with very, very high throughput. It goes back to like lowering friction, making Lightning easy to use, accessible. We've automated all the flows that Graham was talking about. We started manually. In fact, you know, my co-founder James was running a Raspberry Pi in his closet with a Lightning node, rebalancing, and it became a full-time job. And then we're like, look, there's AI. We can automate all of this and just, you know, get to the next level that way.
Graham?
I completely agree, and I think that being able to bridge like the technical improvements to enhance what's possible in the Lightning Network, and then making that into a servable product that ultimately reaches end users is, you know, where we're seeing how do we increase the robustness. And I think that the view that we have at Voltage, you know, we've had a really unique view of how people use Lightning today. What are people wanting? What are people not wanting? And being able to adapt with that. So I think it comes down to the classic product development strategy of listening to your users. How are people using this thing? And then answering those directly, and by how you answer those is probably likely a mix of both protocol level improvements as well as just improvements inside of your own product, your own systems, all of those things.
Love it. Well, thank you so much, gentlemen. This has been a pleasure. Give a round of applause.
Thank you.
Thank you
so much.
Thank you so much, guys. So interesting. Thanks.